So in the opening section of Tsongkhapa's presentation of Special Insight, which is on page 107, I think it's chapter 7 of the book, he cites from Samadhiraja Sutra, King of Meditation Sutra, where Buddha states the following: although worldly persons cultivate concentration, they do not destroy the notion of self. The point is being made in this sutra citation is that although people who attain a triangular abiding and on that basis cultivate a special insight that involve comparing the characteristics of the states of desire realm and higher realms, and on that basis cultivate attainment of the form and formless states. Although they have attained and heightened states of mind, but because the focus here is more on the characteristics of the different realms, therefore, so far as the grasping at this at one's own self is concerned, these meditations leave the grasping at self totally intact and untouched. And because of this, the grasping remains in them. And so long as the self-grasping remains in the individual, then as Dharmakirti points out in his Pramanavartika, Exposition of Valid Cognition, where he says, where there is self, then there is the there's the notion of the other. And on the differentiation of self and other, then attachment and aversion arises, which then give rise to a whole host of problems. Similarly, from our own personal experience, we can attest to what Chandrakirti states in his Entering the Middle Way, where when he says that first we grasp at the notion of I am, self, and then from there we grasp at things as mine. So we know that when there is a strong grasping at self, then the grasping at things that belong to you, things that are related to you, including your own friends and families, and the stronger the grasping is, the stronger it leads to attachment, aversion, and so on. And in fact, one thing that is common, one insight that is common to all the Buddhist schools is the recognition that it is the grasping at self that lies at the root of the afflictive mental states such as attachment and aversion. So it is grasping at the self that give rise to these afflictions. That insight is common to all schools of Buddhism. So because the meditation on tranquil abiding and mundane vipassana based upon it do not touch and do not undermine this grasping at self, so even the person who has attained such advanced state is vulnerable to the arising of these afflictions. So therefore the sutra says that afflictions return and disturb them. So the point being made here is that although in those heightened meditative states, gross levels of afflictions may have been temporarily diminished, but because their seeds of these afflictions have not been removed, eliminated, therefore, when the conditions arises, then these afflictions will resurface. And then the sutra gives the example, as they did with Udraka, who cultivated concentration in this way. So Udraka was historically one of the earlier teachers of the Buddha. So Buddha is giving Udraka as an example of this.
That's the issue. The long time, the day,
Continuing the citation from the sutra, in the latter section, Tsongkhapa cites on page 108 another quotation from the same sutra, when he cites the following: if you analytically discern the lack of self in phenomena, and if you cultivate that analysis in meditation, the citation goes, this will cause the result, attainment of nirvana. So what the sutra is stating is that if in the in contrast, the person is able to discern the lack of self in all phenomena by means of critical analysis that discriminates into the characteristics of phenomena, then and particularly lack of selfhood in the sense of all phenomena being devoid of existence in their own right by means of an inherent nature, then and as one cultivates the familiarity of that understanding and develops a deep sense of ascertainment and conviction and internalize that understanding within oneself, then one will be able to recognize all phenomena in the light of an illusion-like quality. And so when that happens, this insight will undermine the grasping at self. And since the grasping at self, which is the deluded mental state, is not an inseparable essential quality of the mind itself, then as a result of gaining insight into the nature of mind, this grasping at this deluded state of mind can be removed. And in this way, the pollutants of the mind will be eliminated, and in this way, this will lead to the attainment of nirvana. So the sutra states that this will cause the result, attainment of nirvana. And then the question arises, are there any other gateways or doors to liberation other than the realization of no self, whether there is an alternative second door or a third door? And then here the Buddha states that there is no peace or there is no tranquility through any other means. And here, as Dharmakirti points out in his Pramanavartika, a valid exposition of valid cognition, that given that loving kindness and so on do not directly counteract, oppose ignorance, they cannot eliminate ignorance. So here, the sutra is also stating that although cultivation of loving kindness and so on are conditions necessary to attain Buddhahood, but because they do not directly oppose or counteract the perspective of self-grasping, they cannot be the antidote powerful enough to eliminate them. It is only the realization of no self that is the antidote that will eliminate the grasping.
Mm. Yeah.